Okay, so the goal is really to keep this legacy alive in some way, and it's going to be more up to each of us to do that rather than to go through the project. But I hope that this has launched a lot of you to keep going into the north, to branch into our communities by and make the connections that we've made with the program and will continue to build up. So that's one of our major goals, is to keep the legacy alive. We've got community-based projects that are going to continue under both CCAT and ArcticNet. ArcticNet, as I said to you before, it looks like a renewal that we're looking to go down that community research road. It will be a lot wider in the renewal of ArcticNet, so look for that. Put proposals into it, so it'll be a future funding avenue for continuing that sort of work, but not just that. We've got, obviously, the Carbon Flux Network is already established. As Peter showed, they're trying to keep it going, and I really hope they do. But it's so fantastic to see that now with those towers all around America. It's just so great, and we can lead the way in understanding how our systems are reacting to climate change and how the carbon balances is changing. And so they've already looks like they're on their way to having synthesis at least within the next year. We'll try to facilitate that, I'm sure. The vegetation change synthesis, again, this is all linked to the International Thunder Experiment, and we have a synthesis already planned for this coming fall. It will involve a lot of the CCAP researchers. We'll also have work through so Sarah Eleanor was doing. Description of the state of the Arctic kind of vegetation across the north. Be ongoing, and again, of coordinating through the work that Pam will help us with. The soil process people will certainly keep on working. I know they've got a field work plan in at least the high Arctic at Alexander Fjord and at Churchill this year. So they'll have another field season. And then, as Rob showed, his model is testing of the Daring Lake data from Alan and Peter. Is working really well. And as Robert's always saying, he can model anything. So we just have to get the data. Maybe we should take him up on that and see whether we can actually make them all. So one of the goals of the next 2 years is to work on data management to get data to Robert so that fine-tune this model and get the modeling side of the project up to the level that he's really looking forward to getting it to. Ultimately, it's because we are a research-based funding program, we're measured on this on a whole bunch of fronts. But one of the major metrics, of course, is what we put out as individual papers describing results from master's and PhD level research at individual sites and then combining that into synthetic products. So ultimately, how we get out into the literature is a major metric of how successful our project was. And that is the phase we're in now. That's really where we have to come up with. As I showed you, we've already got 12 publications directly linked to funding, and that's only going to skyrocket because of the size of the group we are and the quality of the scientists that we are, the quality of the researchers. So it's going to be pretty exciting to see what the next annual report has in it. I'm going to plug this one again. The state of the Hunter ecosystem in Canada. Look for me to be bothering you for information on a review paper in the fall that is essentially have a title like this, and it will have for each of our themes a section of the paper that will be spent extensively by the readers of that theme, and then we'll put a paper in the paper and put it into an appropriate. just as a good start to our synthetic court. As I said, I think we can write that pretty well by sitting down in a room with the leaders in 3 days. We have enough information for that. We've talked about not only products, of course, the scientific side. We're also going to be, as Scott has shown for his project, with his materials for schools. There's a lot of material that we could produce for schools, not just the poster calendar that Jose messed out for the year. There's probably other material we could think of that we could use our information to produce. We could just find out if there are people who are interested in using our material. I know the Tree Line group has a education, their master's in education to develop a curricula for renewable schools based on vegetation change. And so that sort of thing can make our information available too. The media presentations and interviews are also part of that product of getting our word out. I'm going to be interviewed and I'm inviting a number of you, I hope, to come along with the CKLB. It's coming this afternoon to interview hopefully a couple of us on what we did. It's too bad they didn't come a couple of days ago, so they actually see what we were doing. But that sort of thing. And hopefully we can have those interviews available either, of course, on their website or to ours as well, so we can see that getting word out, at least at that level, has been happening. Materials for the website, this is going to be one of the things that Pam is going to be leading and bugging people to do, because this is another part of the legacy. As I said, I chose the URL as IPY Tundra, not CCAT.ca. What's that going to be for 10 years? No one's going to even type that into Google. But if you put in Tundra, you put in IPY, then that site's going to come back up. So we need to make sure that is an information legacy. And I, you know, once the project's over, I'm going to do what I can to keep that going, or hand it off to someone that has the ability to keep it going. But it is one of our major information package legacies, I think. So you'll be asked for, right off the bat, I would really like everyone to send PDFs and posters. So this will go up as a part of the medium. The last few days. And then always, as leaders of IPY projects are told to do, is to bring up data management and to think about how you're going to push your data out to get available as quickly as possible. It's a little easier for some of us who deal with electronic and mainly American data. It's a little less, or a little more difficult interviews, putting video interviews on, the way we store those. But we really do have to think about how we're going to make these data available. And so that other people, if they want to, can get at it using other modules and other synthetic products that we haven't really thought about how to use it. So we have to do some, we have to think about our data management. And again, that's sort of what I've anticipated. There will be data depositories available through IPY. And then so we'll be asked to submit to those. There's already large databases that you can submit a lot of your data to. And the problem is none. We have been directed to from IPY which ones we should actually be putting our data to just yet. They're almost to that state of equity. And so there'll be announcements about where to, what databases of the future. If I just come up with your own sort of way of doing it. And I think